sorry was needed. Claiming black as night, cloistered in injustice, dead in the eye of time. Nobody is losing. Faces merge and change, but your face remains the same.
November, friends, happy weird transition period that we've entered from fall to holiday-ness. October was a ride. It was a long, chaotic, super fun, spooky ride, and I am missing it. I definitely have the October blues. On top of everything that's happened in October, I've been sick for the past 2 weeks. It's been like an on and off kind of like allergy induced cold, and I always get these seasonally during the big transition months from like summer to fall and then spring to summer, when there's just major fluctuation in the temperature, my allergies go crazy and I get sick. And even being like on prescription like nasal spray medication, I still sometimes will get sick. And I think with how run down my body has gotten from just doing so much in October between work and personal life things, my body just needed to tell me to slow the hell down. And that is what we're doing this weekend, friends. Self-care and books and slowing down and just kind of reflecting and preparing for the next season. Little glimpses, because we're not fully in winter mode yet or holiday mode yet. I know that some people are November 1st, Christmas is here girlies, and that is not me. I need time to prepare mentally for that, and I still want to keep up my fall and Halloween decorations. I'm more of a around Thanksgiving time I will put my decorations up, and since I'm also a content creator, there's always this war in my head of how early to post holiday content. So let me know down below, are you already in holiday mode, or are you more of a late November kind of holiday person? I've been enjoying my Poem for Every Autumn Day book, and we started a new month, of course. So I've enjoyed the November poems so far, and today is technically November 2nd, and I thought it was fun because one, it's All Souls Day. They have a poem from Macbeth by William Shakespeare on here, which I love. And then the other poem they have is Television by Ronald Dahl. I love the fun fact. Today, November 2nd in 1936, was the world's first high-definition television broadcast took place on this day by BBC engineers, of course. And I just love those fun facts. And so Ronald Dahl's poem is just kind of talking about how bad it is that people and children specifically are like glued to the television. And can you just imagine, like, this is a new technology and society is so used to entertaining themselves without a screen of moving pictures. I mean, for our like society and generation, even my parents' generation grew up on television. When I was reading this, like, Ronald Dahl is basically saying, like, go back to doing what you did before you watched TV and got sucked into TV. And what was that? Reading. I just think this is so funny because now we're kind of repeating this as a society with the internet and social media and all the negativity and positivity that that has brought to us. And I guess video games can be slumped into that too, like with the war on children like being glued to their screens. Get outside, get out and read. So I'm gonna be reading all weekend. I'm currently reading One Dark Window by Rachel Gillig, and I told you guys the story of this, I think, in my fall reading video, so I won't give you that story. Go check out that video anyway to see what books I was planning to read this season. And this is one of the books from my fall TBR. We're halfway through. We're a little over halfway through. And I heard about this book many moons ago, but just never was interested in reading it. It wasn't the perfect time for me to read it. And then recently, like the past couple of months, I've seen it on reading vlogs that I've clicked on and random people on social media talking about it. And finally, I got the bug. I got the urge that I need to check this out and see what I am gonna think of it. From the people that I've seen talk about it, it's like a 4.5, 5-star read. It's like kind of reinvigorated their reading, and it's a fantasy with romance elements. I don't know if I will dare say it's a romantasy, but it's definitely a fantasy, and I did not know it was a young adult book until later on, like after I already wanted to read it. So I feel like going into it, like those were kind of, the young adult factor might skew how I will enjoy this book because I'm not a huge YA reader. You guys know that. So I'm enjoying it so far. I feel like by the halfway part, I should have a idea if I'm loving the book or not, and I'm not loving it. It's definitely engaging and interesting, and I want to find out what happens, and I really love the magic system that's been shown to us so far. I don't want to give too much away, but there's like a card deck featured in the whole kind of magic system, and there's kind of a little illustration in the back of one of the cards. So I really enjoy that whole thing, that I enjoy that whole element the author has created in this world and how it's playing into the plot. I think I'll have more thoughts as I finish it on just what I don't like. It's not even that I don't like, it's just all kind of like, yeah, I like that, but not like, oh my god, I love this. This is like giving me like anxiety. This is getting me super emotional. Like I don't feel engrossed in the characters, and I don't feel like I'm emotionally at stake as a human reading this. I know I really love a book when I'm like super emotional and I'm thinking about it and I'm just enthralled in the characters and the plot and I'm like on the edge of my seat. So that's kind of where I'm at with One Dark Window. I did buy the sequel to this, so I'm planning to read the second one because, like I said, I'm enjoying the story, but I don't know if I love it. So that's the true test of my weekend. I'm hoping to finish this by tomorrow. I started it 2 days ago, so it definitely reads quickly if you have the time and space to put into reading it. So that's what we're doing today. I'm doing a lot of reading. I think my goal is to get to at least a 300 page mark today, maybe even the 350 page mark would be a stretch goal. I mean, super stretch goal is to finish it. I don't think that's gonna happen, but we shall see. With being sick, I've started to get stir crazy because this past week I have taken some time off from work just because working at an archives and having allergies and being sick from your allergies, not a good combo. And at first I had like a post-nasal drip situation and it was like contained. Like I was able to go to work and like function with this cold in the background. But this week I got a bad cough that kind of developed a few days ago. So that's when like it kind of crossed over into, I need to take some time off, especially since we had a lot going on at work between like an event that we had to show up for. I got 90 boxes of records from one church and that I'm still going through, and just the daily chaos that is working at an archives where anything could happen. So I was like going hard at work and not taking time off to deal with my sickness. So finally this week it was a slower period, and I was, the cough just kind of like, yeah, Sheila, you need to like chill and stay home, even though I will always feel guilty even if I'm sick. That's definitely been something I've been working through over this past like 2 years really, on my burnout journey. Self-care is important, friends, and especially if you're sick, like I feel like preemptive self-care is so important. This is something else that I wanted to talk about, like how this week I really needed to just set a boundary for myself and be like, okay, I need to take some time off and not feel guilty about it, because if I don't, I'm just gonna keep running myself down and it's going to lead to bigger sickness or just more burnout. and proactive self-care, preemptive self-care, self-monitoring. It's very difficult when you're kind of in a momentum period where there's a lot going on and there's just nobody else. There's no external kind of accountability to be like slow down. And that's when I think our bodies, when we like physically get sick and get ill, that's our bodies, like that's kind of the last resort that our bodies have to tell us to like actually slow down, because we don't have anybody else or ourselves telling us that. So that's been my experience, I think, this whole week and the past 2 weeks of dealing with slowing down, taking breaks, self-care, and just trying to get better. Making self-care moves, friends. I've come to the park to do a little walk slash hike. I've not been here in a long time, really all fall season because it's just been so busy. And I have leg pain, groin pain, and I've been on a journey of rediscovering how to move my body with this pain. And I did talk to my doctor about it, and they said that I need to put heat on the area. Basically, it's kind of, I've like strained my muscles. It's really hard to heal it when you're on your feet and constantly like moving those parts of your body. So this has been a humbling journey. I'm still very much in the thick of the journey, but my doctor said to put heat or ice on it to see if that helps. And if eventually doesn't get any better, then I'm gonna have to go back in, and she suggested probably physical therapy would be the next step. So I have like the next steps if this does not get any better. And it's been really hard because I love doing yoga, and a lot of the poses that I do that help me stretch the other parts of my body involve like stretching my leg, my groin area. So like child's pose I love doing, and like goddess pose, and all these poses where I have to like you know, get my legs out, and it's been a struggle. So I haven't been really walking either, because that's long walks longer than like 30 minutes is really when I started to feel the pain. Like this year, like back in April, I went on a long walk hike, and it really, really severely strained the area. And I was like, oh, I'll bounce back, you know, it's just sore, and it's just been kind of lingering there ever since. So yeah, getting old, having body ailments, it's all difficult. And I think also being a woman and knowing that female bodies have not been studied by the medical system, you know, until recently, I got angry over that too, because misogyny, patriarchy. All right, let's go have a little walk and enjoy the scenery, friends.
Thank you.
I'm at home, friends. I've cozied up on the bed for a little afternoon cozy reading interlude. I've made some lemon tea. I have heat on my groin area. I'm actually using a sock. And don't worry, after using this sock for probably like 10 years, low-key not lying, I finally ordered a heating pad that's supposed to be coming tomorrow. That's my big girl purchase of the week.
I'm also doing laundry, hence why the bed looks like this, but yeah, I'm gonna read a little bit. I've gotten to page 262. I realize that if I get to like part three, I will be content today, at least. Part three, where are you? Here we go. That's how much I want to read today, tonight, right now. We can do that. And of course, we're cozied up with a fall, autumn ambiance video. Yay.
I'm also going to play some Animal Crossing. I do want to talk to you guys about some cozy fall games I recently downloaded. Honestly, I should do that now. Let's do that now.
So I've had my Switch since last Christmas, and I've exclusively been playing Animal Crossing. I did download some other games, and I play Mario Kart, you know, intermittently, but Animal Crossing, I just get sucked into it, and when I'm into a game, that's all I play. But I've been getting kind of burned out with it. I've been working on my island, making it super, super autumnal and spooky now that November is here, and I decided to branch out while I was sick and get some other games. So I got Witchy Life Story, which is super, super cute. It's definitely not as intense as Animal Crossing. It's a cheaper, less developed game, if that makes any sense, but it's super cozy. I love the artwork, and I've been enjoying that. I literally played it like once, but I really enjoyed it when I played it. Maniko's Night Market is another kind of cozy, it's like an entrepreneurial sim game where basically the object is you are Maniko and she needs to like craft things and sell things at a night market once a week. So that's fun. I downloaded Strain Horticulture. I've been wanting to play that ever since I like got a Switch but never downloaded it, and it was on sale for like $6. I think it's still on sale. This game were both on sale. I think they're still on sale in the Nintendo store. I downloaded a free game called Palia. I have not tried it at all. I heard about it through Cozy K, who recommended it in like a fall cozy game reel, so I'm gonna check that out sometime. And then of course we have Mario Kart, Nintendo Switch Sports. A Short Hike I downloaded last year when I downloaded these three games but never actually played it, but I did play it somewhat within the past year, and I could not get past this one part of the game, and then I got confused and just gave up. And that's how I am with all games. If I don't have like somebody showing me or telling me what I need to do, I get really overwhelmed and I just quit the game. So I've been trying to watch playthrough videos or like YouTube shorts to help me when I get to parts that I don't know how to pass, so I need to go back and do that with A Short Hike. Unpacking, same thing happened with that actually. I was playing it more than A Short Hike and got farther along, but then hit a snag where I was just confused with something and then haven't played it since. But it's like a cozy game where you just moved and you have to unpack things, and it's that and A Short Hike are both kind of like cozy, let me rest my brain games where it's very low stakes, and you just kind of, with the Short Hike, you just hike, and that's kind of the premise. It's also a very short game, like it's easy to beat. It's supposed to be just something that you play to unwind. Same with Unpacking. I also got the Oregon Trail, which, hello millennials, I played that in elementary school. I did not even really start it. I did start it and then hit a snag and stopped playing it. I seriously need to watch like a Let's Play video and actually learn how to play that game, because it looks super fun and super nostalgic. Zelda Breath of the Wild is George's game that I started playing and just stopped playing. Like, I definitely want to watch, again, another video to help me with that, but I need, like, time, like, wide pockets of time, like a sick day to kind of explore games. So that's why I always go back to Animal Crossing, because it's comfortable and I know what I'm doing, and when I get on the game, I can just really, like, relax and not have to be, like, stressed out on how to learn the game, if that makes any sense at all. So, yeah, I'm probably gonna play Animal Crossing in a little bit, and I should start Strange Holder Culture. I just want to play them all, but I also want to read. So this is the conundrum of hobbying, right?
Actually, it's the next day from what you just saw, but I didn't, like, film any talking clips yesterday, so it feels like it's 2 days later for me. Anyway, hello, welcome to the ending of this video, where I give you my final thoughts, because I finished One Dark Window Saturday, and, okay, in summary, I felt like the book is in three different parts. I felt like the first two parts were a drag, definitely, like, engaging, and I, like, wanted to know what happened, but I just, you know, it was, like, more of a chore to read it so I could just get to the end. But once we got to part three, it finally, like, picked up for me, and I was, like, emotionally invested a little bit more and was kind of, like, shocked. Or more, maybe not so much shocked, but, like, finally, I, like, actually feel something about the characters and what's going on in this book. And part three quickly ended, and then it really, really sets you up for the second one, which is Two Twisted Crowns, which I already bought. I think I bought these together because I knew I was going to want to read the second one immediately after the first one. But I am not that kind of reader. Being a mood reader, I have to mix things up a lot. So I decided to not go straight into the second one. Instead, I started Time's Convert by Deborah Harkness, and I'm just in my happy place. Like, I am just remembering why I love books and fantasy and historical fiction and witches and vampires, and I love Deborah Harkness. This is book four of the All Souls series, and I'm just enjoying it. This will be my book for this week. We're much happier reading this. It was a fun challenge for me to read this over the weekend, and it definitely read very, very quickly. I think for me, it's just that it has a young adult writing style, writing feel, and I, like, thought it was young adult. Like, good, like, not to trust Goodreads by any means, but Goodreads label, like, this is tagged as young adult, but as I was reading the reviews, as one does, a couple people were saying that this book was marketed as an adult fantasy, and if that is the case, I would be disappointed in this book, but I went into it knowing it was YA-ish, or at least I was going to expect YA writing. So if you are like me and you prefer adult fantasy over young adult fantasy, go in with this book with low expectations. I mainly wanted to read it just to see what I would think of it, knowing that a lot of other people really enjoyed it. So now I know. I thought it was okay. Internally, I'm like, it's meh, but I don't want to like admit that, but I'm admitting it. It was meh. But that's because I'm coming from a viewpoint of somebody that prefers adult fantasy. I feel like if you love YA, this book is right up your alley. Can I talk about positive things? I loved, again, like the magic system, although it didn't go into too much detail and explained further things that I would have liked to have known about the magic system. I still think like it all kind of worked. But for me, like I wasn't really into the characters or like emotionally invested into them or the story really at a very like high stakes level. I'm just kind of like reading it as somebody that's kind of just like viewing from the outside of the window, like wanting to know what's going on so I can talk to my friends or like do a video on it. But I am excited to read the second one. I've heard people prefer the second one, some like the first one, and really it just comes down to what am I gonna think? And that's how I go into my reading. You guys know that. Like every book I read is not gonna be a perfect book. And by no means am I expecting a book to be perfect. That's why when I do read a book that is like a 5-star read, it makes it a 5-star read. So there has to be balance, you know, in the energy of reading, right? In terms of the romance, it's not heavily romantic-y at all, which I definitely enjoyed coming out of other books that I've read in the past. Fourth Wing. It's definitely heavy fantasy, but there is a little bit of spice in it. But I thought it kind of made sense for the story, like unlike some other books out there, that it's purely just spice. Like the book was written for the spice, not for the plot at all, if you guys know what I mean. Oh, here, this is the other thought I was grasping for. The book was clocks in at like 396 pages, and honestly, like I would have read another 200 to 300 pages to have more writing and explanation of the world and the magic system and the characters. Which is why this definitely reads like a YA, because it's a lot quicker and there's not a lot of time spent in developing the world or the characters, and I enjoy that. Yeah, that's why I'm excited that I'm now reading this book and all the feels that it brings me and all the characters, and I've just caught myself smiling several times, and I'm only like 60 pages in, so this will be my book of the week, and I'm very excited for that. Reading aside, yesterday I spent some time trying to like plan out November, or at least mentally prepare for November, and really November is just a time for self-care, friends, rest after all the craziness of September and October, and preparing for the holiday season and the end of the year, which is crazy. It's crazy. And oh yeah, yesterday was daylight savings, which I did not mention at all, but it's not as dramatic to me because we fall an hour back, so had to change the clocks back, and now it's super dark out. Like got home from work and it's dark, but that is the changing of the seasons. I struggle a lot more with spring daylight savings when we have to go an hour ahead. That I dread, but that's not for a couple more months now. So anywho, thank you friends for coming along for this little self-care bookish vlog. I hope you enjoyed it, and let me know what you have read recently or what you're reading this week, and I'd love to hear from you. As always, you can also tell me what you're up to this month. What's going on in November? Are you prioritizing self-care? Because you should. All right, I'm gonna go now. Thank you friends for being here, and I will see you in the next one.